This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana. Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. Take a little time to talk to the Lord. Take a little time to talk.
All right.
Yeah. Take a little time to talk to the Lord. Take a little time to talk.
Oh, a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Take a little time to talk to the Lord.
A little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Take a little time, all right. In troubles of every kind, thank God I'll always find that a little talk with my Jesus makes it right, all right.
How well do I remember when I was...
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
Will we look for safety after it is too late? The same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. Genesis chapter 7, verse 11. The interdiluvians were warned, but the record states that they knew not until the flood came and took them all away. They saw Noah and his wife and their sons and their wives passing into the ark, and the door was closed upon them. Only 8 persons entered that refuge from the storm, and for a week they waited for the rain to come. Daily the sun rose and set in a clear sky, and daily there came to Noah the temptation to doubt. But the Lord has said that the flood was coming, and Noah rested in this word. At the end of 7 days, clouds began to gather. This was a new sight, for the people had never seen clouds. Thicker and thicker gathered the clouds, and soon rain began to fall. Still, the people tried to think that this was nothing very alarming. But soon it seemed as if the windows of heaven had been opened, for the rain poured down in torrents. For a time, the ground drank up the rain, but soon the water began to rise, and day by day it rose higher and higher. Each morning, as the people found the rain still falling, they looked at one another in despair. And each night they repeated the words, "Raining still." Thus it was, morning and evening. For 40 days and 40 nights the rain poured down. The water entered the houses and drove the people to the temples that they had erected for their idolatrous worship. But the temples were swept away. The crust of the earth was broken. And the water that had been concealed in 8 bowls burst forth. Large stones were thrown into the air. Everywhere could be seen human beings fleeing in search of a refuge. The time had come when they would have been only too glad to accept an invitation to enter the ark. Filled with anguish, they cried, "Oh, for a place of safety." Some striked to Noah, pleading for admission into the ark, but amid the furious blast of the tempest, their voices were unheard. Some clung to the ark till they were washed away by the dashing waves. God had shut in those who believed his word, and no others could enter. Parents with their children sought the highest branches of the trees, yet standing. But no sooner had they reached this refuge than the wind flung tree and people into the foaming, seething water. Where now was the ark and those at whom the people had jeered and mocked? Preserved by the power of God, the immense boat was riding safely upon the waters, and Noah and his family were safe inside. Presented by Comfort Asadina and written by Ellen J. White.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I lead you on. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, lead you on.
Hello, welcome to another edition of Youth Corner. My name is Afre Niamakeke. I'm here with Randolph Efrifa Nonowari and Elijah Bedu. They have been with me during the entire discussion on premarital sex, and today we are continuing with that. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Okay, so let's start off by looking at the effects of premarital sex. We'll start by focusing on how it affects the individual. Then we'll look at the society, and we'll further look at how it affects the church, because the individuals are members of the church. They form the church. So let's look at how this really affects an individual.
There are a lot of serious issues with premarital sex, because sex is something that should be a blessing, but as you know, when the pronounces blessings onto anything, the other section of it will be a curse.
So doing the exact opposite of what God remarks as a blessing.
Yes. So premarital sex brings about a lot of problems. Let me attack the spiritual aspect. Maybe before you go into this, you were spiritually strong, you attend church regularly and all that. You realize your connection with Christ was very tight. You always read your Bible, you pray, you sing. But immediately you do this, you automatically break the gap between you
and God.
Mm. That is, you break the relationship. And personally too, your guilty conscience becomes very heavy. You always think that, no, even when you kneel to pray, you realize you are not fit before God. And that is one serious aspect. So before you realize, you started from somewhere, and gradually you'll not be able to pray, and it will come in days, weeks, months, years. Then if you sometimes it even affects many people's church styles. Mm-hmm. Whereas you realize he'll even stop church, and he'll be doing more.
We'll focus on the
church,
that's how it affects the church later. So yeah.
Okay. So, no, that is personal, mm-hmm. your spiritual aspect.
Yeah, yeah.
Your personal spiritual aspect. You realize your connection with God will break. And that is also a very strange aspect of it. So, my advice is no one should even tempt. The best thing is just prepare yourself. A marriage is not about money, money, money. You can plan about whatever you want to do as in marriage. So, try and instead of having a lot of sex, go and marry, and you have free chance. Also, maybe about the personal experience by the young ones. You know, if you are a young person, research tells us that if someone is 14 years or 15 years and goes into premarital sex, you realize before you get married, research tells us that you go into several relationships, several sexual relationships with about 13 to 14 men before you get married. And at the end of it, you realize if you get married, it's going to affect your marriage. Maybe the man has not been into these things for long, or maybe for...
It's not as experienced as...
Has never had this experience. And you have gone through this whole journey. So coming there with the man, you realize maybe the man is inexperienced and he'll bore you. And at the end of the day, you realize you'll be in marriage and also causing adultery. So it has a lot of effect. And everybody has to be very careful with.
All right, interesting. Elijah.
Also look at the
emotion. How does premarital sex, you know, affect the individual?
The individual. I'm dealing with the emotional. You feel that you are guilty. You are always battling with your conscience. You are not free. What I would say is, sex is enjoyed by only married couples. But to those who are not married, it's a pleasure. You don't enjoy it. Because the trauma you even go in will not leave you alone to enjoy it.
After the act.
After the act.
But some people do find that it's a kind pleasure. Of satisfaction even after.
Those are the people who are, they are asleep.
Unless your conscience is seared. Yes. That is the word. Unless your conscience is seared.
Which is very dangerous.
If your conscience is rightly working, there's no way you have sex before marriage. Sex in contrast to what God permits. You will be free with your
okay,
mind.
So I want you to hammer on that point again. You said that sex before marriage can only lead to pleasure.
Yeah. It's pleasure.
And when it is during marriage, it's...
You enjoy it.
Okay.
You have the certificate.
My brother was saying something like, emotionally, you see kind of distract. You will think that I'm doing it with this guy. This guy is doing it with me. I'm also doing it. What shows that if I'm married to this person... So far, this guy is not able to wait till we get married, and he is having it with me. It's possible he can have it with somebody, or as he is having it with me, because he's not patient enough, even though he says he loves me, it's possible he is doing it with somebody.
Yeah.
Sometimes you will be angry with yourselves. You'll be angry. Why did I do this at all? The guilt will generate into anger. Sometimes you're losing your virginity, especially the ladies. It goes a long way affecting some of the ladies to the extent that when there is a breakup, some go to the extent of committing suicide.
Yeah,
that is going through that emotional pain, losing something precious, something valuable, and getting to know that at the end of it all, the guy...
You're not going to end up with that person.
With that person. Your intents are now messed up. You are now no more a virgin. And you've lost that valuable thing that you cherished by somebody who just dumped you. That's a word. And you look at relational issues. Research has also shown that those who engage in premarital sex end up in their marriages cheating. You will cheat. For example, I've never engaged in premarital sex before. I'm not experienced. And I meet a lady who have been out with about 5 people, 5 guys, 6 guys, 7 guys. And I've seen kinds of guys, different styles. And I'm now going to learn. Just imagine what is going to happen. So it's involuntarily. She'll be comparing me
to the others.
Others. And that one will warrant cheating. For that one, unless a person decides to maybe stick to you and follow what God says, that the married bed should be kept clean, as pure, as Hebrews 13:4 says. Other than that, the person will by all means cheat on you. And the moment you people say you are courting or you are dating and sex comes in, communication breaks.
Yeah.
The attention focuses on sex.
Yeah.
Anytime you people are together, what you are thinking about is how to have good sex.
Yes.
How to please your partner.
In fact, that's true.
How to let your partner enjoy the sex. And maybe there is something you don't like about the person or something you like about the person. Taking time to use your faculty reasoning power to really think about what the person is doing. Because you have had sex with a person, that faculty reasoning power God has given to us is diminished. It gets to the lowest minimum that don't even reason.
So that premarital sex also blinds your sense of reason. Very insightful. Thank you so much, Elijah and Randolph. My name is Afrenia Makeke. We have been looking at premarital sex. I've been here with Randolph, Efrifa Nanawari, and Elijah Beidu.
This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope. AWR,
Voice of Hope. We will bring you joy. Keep hope alive.
You can contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
God has smiled on me. He has set me free. God has smiled on me. He's been good to me. God has smiled on me. He has set me free. God has smiled on me. He's been good to me.
Cherished listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me.
Calling for you and me.
See on the portal, he's waiting and watching. Watching for you.
Hello, my dear listener. I thank God for your life. And I welcome you to the moment of truth. I am Pastor Godfred Kwesi Ataboro. I want to share with you the Word of God. The title of this message is Who Made You? Who Made You? And the scripture will be taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 12, verse 13 to 15. I read, someone in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. A man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possession." Amen. Shall we pray? Father, I pray that touch my lips and bless my hearer, for I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. There are so many people who come to Jesus Christ, and the purpose for which they seek him is not the purpose for which Jesus came. Jesus is called the Christ or the Messiah. Matthew chapter 1 verse 21 says that, "And Mary will deliver a son, and the son shall be called Jesus, for he will save his people." Jesus' name outlines his purpose on it. His name is Jesus. God saves. And therefore his name identifies his purpose. And Jesus knew his purpose on earth very well. In fact, this young man who spoke to Jesus, he had a brother, and he had lost their father. And he expected that his brother would share the property and give him his portion. But his elder brother was feeling reluctant to share. And therefore, the Bible says that this young man approached Jesus, knowing that Jesus is a Prince of Peace. When he spoke, there would be peace. Knowing that Jesus is the only righteous judge, he approached him. because the Bible says that Jesus will judge the world in righteousness. And I am sure that this young man knew that Jesus is a righteous judge. This young man knew that Jesus is a man of authority. And when he speak, it shall be. When he says, it shall stand. Therefore, he saw in everything that Jesus is the right person to approach. And so, this young man approached Jesus Christ and spoke to him. Please, Jesus, can you speak to my brother that he will share with me my inheritance? Jesus looked at this young, helpless man. He looked at this young man and said, "Man, who made me a judge or an arbiter over you?" This question Jesus posed to this young man, it seemed that Jesus was rude. It appears that Jesus was not kind enough. But I want to say that Jesus did what he was supposed to do. He asked the man, "Man, woman, who made me a judge or an arbiter over you?" Jesus knew from the beginning what God had purposed for him to do on earth. As I said earlier on, Matthew 1:21 says that the name Jesus means that he is to save man from our sins. And in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verse 49, we are told that Jesus and his parents were going for a function. And Jesus retreated behind. And he went into the temple to teach. His parents sought him and found him not. Then, when they found him, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 2, verse 48 to 49 says, when his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." Verse 49. "Why were you searching for me?" Jesus asked. "Don't you know that I have to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Praise the Lord. The Bible says that Jesus questioned his parents. "Why were you looking for me? Didn't you know that I must be in my father's house going about my father's business?" Jesus always remained focused on his work. Jesus always knew his purpose. And he knew that he came to save. He did not come to settle matters. And when this man approached Jesus Christ, Jesus told him frankly, "I came to save, I did not come to judge." Jesus knew whom he was, why he was here on earth, so he was focused on his mission and never got distracted by anyone. Every man too has a purpose. When we go to Psalm 95 verse 6, the Bible says that, "Come, let us bow down. Come, let us kneel and worship before the Lord our Maker." Psalm 100 verse 3 says that, "Know ye that he is God. It is he who has made us, and not we ourselves." Now the question is, if God made us, for what purpose did God make man? Genesis chapter 1 verse 26 and 27 makes it clear that God said, "Let us make man in our own image, that he may have dominion over the earth and rule over all my creatures." Therefore, man was made in the image of God to reflect and represent his maker. Man was also made to have dominion or to be a steward over the properties of God. In Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5, the Bible says that, "Before I formed you in your mother's womb, I knew you, and I ordained you a prophet." God has a purpose for every man on earth, and that purpose, we must identify it and stick to it. I am praying that you do not get distracted by the cares of this world. You don't get distracted by people or family, but you identify why God made you, and you stick to that purpose. For God will bring every work into judgment. Therefore, whatever you are doing, ask yourself, what does God want me to do? What does God have for me to do in this world? Do that one first, and any other thing is an extracurricular activity. May God bless you as you contemplate to glorify God. May God bless you as you decide to identify His purpose for your life. I pray that God will give you understanding. He will give you discernment. And you open your eyes to see His path. That when He instructs you, you will walk in His path of righteousness. May God bless you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box, AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo Ansedu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.